Hello student, today's news, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has extended the lockdown till 3rd of May. There were many discussions among the people and they said it's the part of politics, but here our PM has taken a step to secure our country. People say it's politics, so let us go. The political science, and let us learn political science. We are going to see the first lesson of political science, working of the constitution. My dear student, our country got independent on 15th of August 1947. Our country was ruled by the tyrannical rule of British government, and before they could leave, they told our political people that your country should have a constitution. According to the constitution, your country should be ruled. So here we are going to see working of the constitution. Our country has written the constitution, how the constitution is getting worked now. My dear students, as this constitution was written, there was a constituent assembly, and those members came together, discussed, and it was written. All the articles were written down. I would like to tell you and remind you also that today is 14th April 2020. 14th April is the birth anniversary of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, who was the architect of our Indian Constituent Assembly. He has put lots and lots of effort to write down this constitution, and therefore I bow before this great personality. Our country has adopted democracy for ruling our nation. And my dear student, this democracy is not a simple democracy, it is sovereign, socialist, secular democracy. So my dear student, in this chapter, we are going to learn these three points, that is democracy, social justice, and judicial system. So let us begin our lesson. So the first topic of today's is democracy. Among the democracy, we are going to see today political maturity, right to vote, and decentralization of democracy. By now, dear students, we have studied local government. Local government means Gram Panchayat, Panchayat Samiti, and Jilla Parishad. This works at the district level. Now we are going to see how our country is been ruled by our Indian constitution. This is been ruled. The norms are written in the constitution. Our constitution is structured by sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. Let me explain to you what is sovereignty. Sovereign means no external power is ruling to us, which means the Indian people is ruling our country. Socialist means we all are equal, and there should not be any gulf between people, rich and poor, and so on. Secular means your country doesn't have any one particular religion. Country respects everyone's religion. Then we have democracy. Democracy means a rule by the people, for the people, to the people. And republic means a country is ruled by the representative, which are elected by the people. This representative forms the parliament, and parliament is ruling our country according to the norms given in the constitution. So, my dear student, we are going to study how our constitution works. My dear students, the constitution came into force on 26 Jan 1950. And since then, our government is working according to the principle and norms of this constitution. In this chapter, we'll take a brief overview of the wide-ranging nature of the Indian democracy. Important changes that have taken place in the politics, political process, and steps that we have taken to establish social justice and equality. Student, as I have told you that we are going to study these 3 points, democracy, social justice, and judicial system. Now we are going to start the first point, democracy. Among this democracy, we are going to study political maturity, right to vote, and decentralization of democracy. So, among the political maturity, according to the Indian people, we have direct representative in the parliament, in the state legislation, and local self-government bodies. Our parliament is formed, that is, our country is divided into several constituencies. We, the people, elect this representative and they form the parliament. This parliament rules the country. The election is conducted in free and fair manner, and the representatives are elected for the term of 5 years. So, my dear student, political maturity. What is this political maturity? Is that holding free and fair election and electing our representative who rules the nation. So this is political maturity of our country. Now let us begin the second point, right to vote. Before we could get independent, our country has a lot of restriction, my dear student, and many groups, people, women sections were not allowed to cast their vote. After the return of the constitution, the provision was made that the right was given for to vote for all the adults, which was considered as adult franchise or adult suffrage. My dear students, you don't have right to go for election and cast your vote. Why do you think so? Because, as I told you, adult suffrage means that at the age of 21, a person becomes adult and then only you cast the vote. But later on, this age was reduced to 18. Because of this, the youngsters got opportunity to take part in the election process and in the politics of India. Second thing was that, so let me explain to you, my dear student, that such provision have made India the largest democracy in the world. Which is this provision? That from 21, the age was reduced to 18, and therefore this has made India a largest democracy. The member of the parliament can be youngsters due to this provision. From our vicinity, I can give you the example of Sujay Patil Vikhe. At the young age, this time he is elected and become the member of parliament. So this change is not only quantitative but also qualitative, as new political parties are emerging with the active support of young voters. And I have given you that we have the new parties also, as Kejriwal's AAM party, and so many different new parties comes up, and youngsters are actively taking part in these parties. These parties represent various expectation of people and compete in the political sphere. Next point is decentralization of power. That is democracy. Decentralization controls the misuse of power. This point I'm going to explain to you on the blackboard. So my dear student, let me explain to you this decentralization of power through this pyramid. First of all, here we are people here. People elect their representatives. This elected representative goes to Delhi and forms the central power, forms the government. Okay, this government rules the entire country. So people elect a representative, they forms the government here and they rules the country. But in the 73rd and 74th amendment and 74th amendment, center has given this power back to people, that is the local self-government body, local self-governing body, that is Gram Panchayat, Gram Panchayat, Panchayat Samiti. Gram Panchayat is at village level, Panchayat Samiti at Taluka level, Panchayat Samiti at Taluka level, and ZP, Jilla Parishad, at district level. So this power from central, it comes back. And in this way, this pyramid is completed. People give power to the elected member, and these parliament members give back this power to the people, and power comes down, is called decentralization. The power come back to the people is called decentralization of power. Moving on to next topic, right to information. This act was enacted in 2005. What is this all about? Citizens' empowerment is the essential condition of democracy. It is necessary to create opportunity for citizens' participation and interaction with the government, which means before 2005, there was no interaction between citizens and government. Now, because of this act, we have got the opportunity to interact. We means we people have got the opportunity to interact with the government. And therefore, my dear student, citizens have a right to know about the functioning of the government, how the government functions. The government of India gave the right to information to the citizen of India to ensure transparency and accountability. So how government is functioning? Are they transparent? Are they accountable to the people and to the nation? Which are the hallmark of good governance? And through this act, we have got a right to question the government. Right to information has made the government more transparent and has reduced the element of secrecy in the working of government. So there is no secrecy. Everything has to be clear before the people, because it is the people's rule. After the year 2000, the whole approach towards democratic reform has changed. Democratic reform are considered as right of citizen. Accordingly, citizens in India have got right to information, right to education, and right to food security. These rights have strengthened democracy in India. So these are our right to information, right to education, RRT, RIE, and RF, that is right to food security. These are important. These are given to us people by the government so that we can check the government, their transparency, their accountability, and their functioning. So my dear students, which are the hallmarks of good governance? I had asked you earlier. I would like to remind you that transparency and accountability is the hallmark of good government. My dear student, enough of this today. Let me revise you in brief what we have studied today. We have studied democracy, social justice, and judiciary. Among these three topics, my dear student, we have studied today democracy. Among this democracy, first we have studied political maturity, secondly, right to vote, third, decentralization of democracy. And one more point which we have studied is RT, that is right to information. Now, tomorrow we are going to see social justice and judicial system. Goodbye and take care.